Okay, hello and welcome to An Academy. So hello and welcome to An Academy, India's largest platform for online civil services education. I am Rajshekhar Reddy and I'll be conducting a mock test today on current affairs. Before starting today's mock test, I would like to tell something about myself. So I have cleared the civil service examination in So I have cleared the civil service examination in 2014, and I have been teaching for the past 7 years, and I have a BTech computer science graduate from JNTU Hyderabad. So you need to download and subscribe to the An Academy learning app to avail the best facilities of the platform. So what are the facilities that a student gets by downloading and subscribing to the An Academy learning app? So you get a number of advantages. So these include daily live classes. So you have live classes on a daily basis, and in these live classes you can ask questions. You can chat with your educator, you can engage in discussions with your educator, and you can answer polls. All these things can be done during the class, that is during the live class. So these classes are interactive in nature and are very helpful in preparing for the civil service examination. So the courses that are available are structured in nature and they comprehensively deal with the syllabus of the examination, and best educators of our country conduct these live tests and quizzes on a regular basis. So these will help you in understanding where you stand as far as the examination is concerned, and you also have unlimited access to the content on the platform, so you can watch these videos any number of times, so without any limitation. So these are the advantages that a student gets by downloading and subscribing to the An Academy learning app. So as I've told you, India's top educators are teaching on the An Academy learning app, and they have designed various courses. So these courses include all the subjects that form part of the civil services examination. So I have designed a course on current affairs. So the name of this course is Top 200 Topics in Current Affairs for Civil Services Prelims 2020. So please watch these videos. So there are 17 videos which cover more than 100 topics. So I'll be uploading more videos on this series, and they will be very helpful for you to crack the prelims examination. So I also have a series called Top 50 Topics in Polity, and this however is available only on the An Academy app. That is An Academy learning app. So there is a third series called Top 50 Topics in International Relations, that is Current Affairs, and this is also available on the An Academy learning app. Okay, so you need to subscribe. There are a number of subscription options available, so you can subscribe for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months and 24 months. The best option is the 24 month subscription, which gives you a 67% discount. You can get an additional 10% discount if you use my code RRUPSC. So please use this code RRUPSC when you subscribe to the learning app, that is taking the plus subscription. You can convert the transaction into no cost EMIs, and this no cost EMI can be extended to 24 months. Okay, so this is about the An Academy learning app and the plus subscription. I hope and expect that you take the plus subscription very soon. So let us start the mock test. So this will be a mock test on current affairs. So there will be 25 questions in this mock test, and I hope you all participate actively in this mock test. So let us start the mock test here. So first question for this exam. So which of the following nations witnessed a military coup in the recent period? So military coup in the recent period. So which country has seen a military coup in the recent period? So the answer for this question is Mali. So it happened very recently, some 10 days ago. So the military actually has staged a coup, and they have sidelined the elected government. Okay, so Mali is the country. It is a country in West Africa, and the capital of Mali is Bamako. Okay, a simple and straightforward question. If you had followed the developments in the newspaper, you can easily answer this question. So let us move on to the next question. So this is also something which is in the news. Which of the following nations recently inaugurated the Baraka nuclear power plant? So which country inaugurated the Baraka nuclear power plant? This power plant was established by the country with the collaboration of South Korea. So which country has inaugurated this Baraka nuclear power plant? So this is a significant development in the recent period. So many countries have actually expressed concern over this development. So which country has inaugurated or commissioned the Baraka nuclear power plant? So the answer for this question is the United Arab Emirates. So nobody actually has answered it. So United Arab Emirates has become the first Arab country to have a nuclear power plant. So they have collaborated with South Korea to produce, to commission the Baraka nuclear power plant. So UAE says that this will be used only for peaceful purposes. So it will be a useful plant. Nuclear power plant, and it will be used only for peaceful purposes. And there are four units out of which the first unit has been commissioned. The United Arab Emirates says once the four units are commissioned, the nuclear power plant will meet the requirements of 25% of the country. So 25% of UAE's power requirements will be met by the Baraka nuclear power plant. Okay. So let us move on to the next question. So this is a straightforward question. It was also in the news. So let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. The term of the Legislative Assembly of 5 years is counted from. So as you all know, the Legislative Assembly of a state, in fact, the Lok Sabha also has a term of 5 years. But like, when do we start counting that period? Okay, so what is the answer? So the term of the Legislative Assembly of 5 years is actually counted from the date of the first meeting of the newly elected house. So option B is the correct answer. So it is not the date on which the election results are announced. It is also not the date on which the MLAs take their oath. And it is also not the date on which the governor summons the house. So the answer is the first meeting. So this is very interesting in the context of Bihar. Assembly elections will be held very soon, or they are expected to be held in the months of October and November. However, because of COVID-19, there is a talk that these can be postponed. But can the elections be postponed? The Constitution does not allow for the postponement of elections. So the term of the assembly ends on November 29, 2020. I think the first day that this assembly met was on November 30, 2015. So you have to count 5 years from this particular day, which means it will end on November 29, 2020. So by this time, a new house must be elected. And if there is no new house, then there is no other option but to impose a president's rule under Article 356 of the Constitution of India. So if elections are not held to the state of Bihar, then the only option that will be left for Bihar after November 29th is the imposition of the president's rule. Okay, so this is something which is important. It has been in the news. There was a lot of discussion. The Election Commission of India has requested political parties to give their opinions on whether to conduct the elections or to postpone the elections. But whatever may be the case, the term of the Legislative Assembly cannot be extended beyond 5 years, that is beyond November 29th. Okay. So this is a straightforward, simple question. Cyclone Nisarga is named by which of the following nations? Cyclone Nisarga. Hi, Neelam. So, Cyclone Nisarga is named by which of the following nations? So, let me see how many of you can write this or answer this correctly. So, nobody. So, fun with Dikshit. Yes, very good. Bangladesh is the answer. Yes, this is very important. For the examination, you must know the procedure by which cyclones are named. This is a commonly asked question in the exam. So, cyclones are named by a procedure that is adopted by 13 countries. So, this has been changed. Earlier, only 8 countries were involved in the naming of cyclones, but now 13 countries are involved in the naming of cyclones. Each country gives a list of 13 names, so a total of 169 names is maintained by the Indian Meteorological Department. So what are the countries that are involved in the naming of cyclones? So please go through the list. So the Bangladesh, India, Oman, Thailand, Maldives, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, so I'm missing one important country. Myanmar. So these were the countries which were involved earlier. I think 5 more countries have been added. So these include Iran, in Saudi Arabia, Yemen, Qatar, I think the United Arab Emirates. So please check the list once. This is very important. Let me clarify the list here. So, Iran, Qatar, UAE, Yemen and Saudi Arabia, yes. So, these are the 13 countries which are involved in the naming of cyclones. So, every country gives a list of 13 names, and these names are maintained by the Indian Meteorological Department. So, one after the other, that is in the alphabetical order, the list will be taken. So, this is the first name in the new list. So, Nisarga is the first name in the new list, and this has been provided by Bangladesh. So this has created a lot of havoc in Maharashtra, parts of Maharashtra. Before this, there was another cyclone which devastated West Bengal, Umphan or Amphan. So this was the last name in the previous list. So this was the last name in the previous list of 64 names, and this was provided by Thailand. Okay. So, please remember the countries that are involved in the naming of cyclones. So, a commonly asked question in the examination. So, Cyclone Nisarga is named by Bangladesh. So, let us see how many of you can answer the next question correctly. The United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea or UN Clause entered into force in which year? In which year has the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea entered into force? Okay, so what is the answer for this question? This is actually a tough question. The answer for this question is 1994. So this is a convention which was opened for signature in 1982 and it entered into force in 1994. So this convention describes the rights which countries enjoy over the surrounding, over the surrounding water body. So the rights which countries enjoy over the surrounding water body are mentioned in the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. So the water body is divided into various zones. So these zones are territorial waters, very, very important for the exam. So territorial waters, which extends up to 12 nautical miles. So 1 nautical mile is some 1.85 kilometers. Then beyond the territorial waters, we have what is called the contiguous zone. Contiguous zone extends for 12 nautical miles from the edge of the territorial waters. Then beyond the contiguous zone, we have the exclusive economic zone, which extends for 200 nautical miles. So 200 nautical miles from the baseline, not from the edge of the contiguous zone. So this is very, very important. So over each zone, the country enjoys certain rights. So please study about the rights which countries enjoy in every specific zone. A very, very important topic. This is often in the news. So for example, we have the Sir Creek dispute. So we come across the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, because the maritime boundary has not been demarcated. Then we had this dispute between Turkey and Greece, which was in the news. This also has seen the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. So very, very important treaty. And you can also, you must have also heard about the Italian Marines case, which was taken to the International Tribunal on the Law of the Sea. So this is an organization which was established under the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. So very, very important. This has been in the news. So a potential question for this year's exam. Okay. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. Which of the following acts was enacted by the Parliament allowing for the termination of unwanted pregnancy? So this is a controversial act. So there have been demands to amend this act. So recently the Parliament has decided to amend this act. So there is a bill which is pending before the Parliament to amend the act. If you have followed the developments in the newspaper, then you can easily answer this question. So the answer for this question is so this is a straightforward question, and the answer for this question is MTP Act. So medical termination of pregnancy Act. So this was enacted in the 1970s, and this allows for the abortion of unwanted pregnancy. However, this law is very controversial, and some changes are being made to this law. So there is a bill which is pending. So study the changes that are being made to this law. Very, very important. Yes, so abortion is permitted up to 20 weeks under this law. Now this has been increased to 24 weeks. And it can also go beyond 24 weeks if the medical board approves it. Okay. So there are some other provisions, very important provisions. Only married women are allowed to terminate their pregnancy under the old act, that is the MTP Act. But now any woman can terminate her pregnancy, unwanted pregnancy. So very, very important. So let us move on to the next question. So geographical indication and the state. So I have given three pairs here. So these are geographical indications. Hi, Davda. So what is the, all these products were given geographical indication status very recently. So this is a commonly asked question in the prelims examination. So if you have not read about geographical indications, you have to study them thoroughly. Okay, let me see the answer here. So first, Theliyarumal, yes. It is from the state of Telangana. So Kovilpatti Kadalai Mitai, it is not from Kerala, it is from Tamil Nadu. And Ambavur wood carvings are from Tamil Nadu. So the answer for this question is A and C only. So all of you have actually got this wrong. Okay. So very, very important. So if you have not read about the geographical indications, so please go through them. So welcome to my class. I'm in Zankhana. I'm sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly. So the answer is A and C only. And please study about geographical indications. A very, very important topic for the examination. There are a number of products for which geographical indication status is given, and you start reading from the bottom of the list, that is from the latest products to the oldest. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Remdesivir was developed by which of the following organizations? So this is a drug which is often in the news. So this is said to be the most effective drug to treat COVID-19 patients. As you all know, COVID-19 is a pandemic. It has resulted in the deaths of lakhs of people. So there is no specific treatment that has been approved for COVID-19. So there is no specific treatment. A number of drugs are experimented on COVID-19 patients. So among them, Remdesivir has shown a lot of promise. So which organization produces this drug? So, fun with Dikshit, very good. You have answered this correctly. So, the answer for this is Gilead. So, Gilead Sciences, which is an American multinational company, has produced Remdesivir. It was initially produced to deal with what is called Ebola virus. It was, however, not effective in treating Ebola patients. So, this is a patented drug. The patent is held by Gilead. However, they have signed non-exclusive licensing agreements. So they have signed non-exclusive licensing agreements with several companies in India, Pakistan and Egypt to produce this drug for sale in most as many as 127 countries. Okay. So for example, Hetero Drugs has produced this drug under the name Covifor. Okay, so very important. So this is said to be the most potent drug in treating COVID-19. So Gilead Sciences is the organization which produces this. There has been a lot of debate regarding the price of this drug. So the price of a single dose is somewhere between 30,000 to 40,000. That is the price at which Hetero Drugs or other companies are selling it. This itself is also very high and it is not afforded by most people. So there are demands made by some political parties to issue what is called compulsory license. Compulsory license under section 92 of the Indian Patents Act of 1970. Okay, if you have not read about the Indian Patents Act and compulsory license under the Indian Patents Act, so please go through this. Very, very important for not just the prelims examination but also for the mains exam. So let me move on to the next question. Let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. Bank rate is charged against loans offered by the central bank to commercial banks, whereas repo rate is charged for repurchasing the securities sold by the commercial banks to the central bank. No collateral is involved while charging bank rate, but securities, bonds, agreements and collateral is involved when the repo rate is charged. So if you have not read about the key policy rates, I have told you that you must know the definitions of key policy rates. So there are four key policy rates. These are repo rate, reverse repo rate, marginal standing facility rate, MSF rate, and we also have the bank rate. So you must know the definitions. You also must know the definition of SLR. You must know the definition of CRR. What is the Monetary Policy Committee, CPI, etc. So there are a number of definitions that you come across in the economy component of the civil service exam. So you must be thorough as far as definitions are concerned. Here I asked you a question on the difference between the bank rate and the repo rate, and both these statements are correct. So bank rate is charged by the Reserve Bank of India against loans that are offered by the Reserve Bank of India. So in this case, there is no collateral involved. So there is no collateral. However, repo rate is charged by the Reserve Bank of India on a short-term basis to banks on the promise. So banks will make a promise to repurchase them at a future date. So repo rate is significantly different from the bank rate. But there is a lot of confusion. And you must know that the bank rate is always higher. So bank rate is always higher than the repo rate. Okay. So very important, if you have not read about the definitions of various economic terms, so please go through them. Very important. So let us move on to the 10th question for today's exam. So the provisional growth rate registered by India in the financial year 2019 and 20. So what is the growth rate registered by our account? This is provisional, so this is subject to change. So the government of India released the provisional estimates. What is the growth rate registered by the Indian economy? So nobody. Okay, so the answer is 4.2%. So you must know the figures here. Very important. So in the year, financial year 2018-19, India has registered a growth rate of 6.1%. However, we have registered a significantly lower growth rate of 4.2% this year. And the last quarter has been much worse. So the last quarter's growth rate is just 3.9%. So as you all know, GDP is the money value of all final goods and services produced within a country in 1 year. So here 1 year is calculated from April 1st to March 31st. So this is the financial year. So the answer is 4.2%, very important for this year's exam. So there is also a discussion going on in our country that we may see recession in the year 2020-2021 because of COVID-19, there is a high chance that the economy may contract. So instead of expanding, our Indian economy may contract this year. So how much, by what percentage will the Indian economy contract is all guess. So some people say it will contract by 4%, some people say it will contract by 15%, some others say it will contract by as much as 25%. So we'll have to wait and see what will be the impact, or what is the impact of COVID-19 on the Indian economy. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. So 11th question. The maximum number of judges, including the Chief Justice of India, in the Supreme Court, under the Supreme Court Number of Judges Act. So what is the current strength or the maximum strength of the Supreme Court, including the Chief Justice of India? So maximum number of judges, including the Chief Justice of India, in the Supreme Court, under the Supreme Court Number of Judges Act is... So this is a straightforward question. The number of judges were increased. Earlier it was 31, it was increased to 34. So the last time the number was increased was way back in 2009. So after 10 years, the government has taken a decision to increase the number of judges. So the total number of judges here is 34, that is 33 judges plus one Chief Justice of India, which is 34. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. The number of cities in India certified as 5-star cities under the protocol for, so this year is under the protocol for star rating of garbage cities, garbage free cities are. So how many cities in our country have a 5-star rating? So as far as cleanliness is concerned, how many cities have a 5-star rating? So this is an initiative of the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. So what are the cities that have a 5-star rating? So Garbage Free Cities Network has four categories of ratings. So that is 7-star rating, 5-star rating, then 3-star rating, 1-star rating. So there is no city in our country which has a 7-star rating, but 5-star rating is given to 6 cities. So the answer is 6. So 3-star and 7-star, many cities have these star ratings. If you want me to give you the names of the cities which enjoy these, so 65 cities have a 3-star rating. And 70 cities have 1-star rating. So what are the cities that are the cleanest cities of our country? So Ambikapur, Rajkot, Surat, Mysuru, Indore, Navi Mumbai. So these cities are the cleanest cities of our country. So this is an initiative of the The Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. Okay, so I hope you have noted the 6 cities, very important. So let us move on to the next question. Consider the following statements on the Brew Quadripartite Agreement. So there was a very famous agreement or an important agreement which was signed. So several developments have taken place with respect to the northeastern part of India. So these developments aim at bringing peace to the northeast. So here we come across what is called the Brew Agreement or the Brew Quadripartite Agreement. So what are the salient features of the Brew Quadripartite Agreement? So this agreement I think was signed in January 2020. And it involves 4 parties. So who are the 4 parties? So one is the Government of India. The other is the Tripura Government. The third is the Mizoram government, and fourth is the Brew organizations. Okay. So what are the salient features of this particular agreement? So first, let me check this first statement. The demand for an autonomous development council for Brews in Tripura on the lines of the Tripura Tribal Areas Autonomous District Council was accepted. So this is a wrong statement. So they have not accepted the creation of a new autonomous district council. So I think you know something about the Brews. So Brews are people who inhabit parts of Northeast, but mostly they are found in Mizoram. They came into clash with the locals in 1997, and they were forced to move out of Mizoram, and they have been settled in refugee camps since 1997 in Tripura. So since that period, there have been a number of efforts to bring peace to this region. However, these efforts have not succeeded. So the final effort was made recently, and most of the Brew organizations have accepted it. So however, they actually asked for creating an autonomous district council or a development council. This has not been accepted. The second statement is, under the new agreement, around 34,000 BRU refugees will be settled in Tripura and would be given aid from the center to help with their rehabilitation and all-round development. This is correct. So here the answer is B only. So nobody has answered this question. Okay, so you all must be knowing that under the sixth schedule, autonomous district councils are created. So this is applicable in the states of Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura, and Mizoram. So there are three autonomous district councils in Assam, three in Meghalaya, one in Tripura, and three in Mizoram. So the BRUs also wanted to have their own autonomous district council, but this demand has not been accepted by the government of India. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. So here I have given you three pairs. So these three pairs are with respect to tiger reserves. So are they correctly matched or not? So Dampa Tiger Reserve, so this is in Mizoram, this is correctly matched. Satkosia Tiger Reserve is in Odisha, so this is also correct. Simlipal Tiger Reserve is also in Odisha, this is also correct. So all the above. So how many reserves are there? How many tiger reserves are there? Can you answer in the comment section or chat box? How many tiger reserves are there? Yes, very good, Neelam. So there are 50 tiger reserves. So Project Tiger, which was started in 1973 with 9 tiger reserves. So the number of tiger reserves have increased to 50. So very recently, a number of details have been released as far as the status of tigers are concerned. So we have some 2,967 tigers. So India is one of the few countries in the world which has been successful in its conservation efforts, so to protect this animal, or a very famous animal. So let us move on to the next question. Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations was signed in the year. So in which year has this very famous convention signed? So hi Akash. This is a straightforward question. So Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations was signed in the year. So the answer is 1961. 1961 is the year in which the Vienna Convention on Diplomatic Relations was signed. You have come across this Diplomatic Relations Convention in the context of India-Pakistan relation. So very, very important for the exam. Okay, so 1961 is the answer. Very good. So let us see the next question. So this is about the blacklist of the Financial Action Task Force. So countries known as non-cooperative countries or territories are put in the blacklist, which is also called high-risk jurisdiction subject to a call for action of the FATF. These countries support terror funding and money laundering activities. So countries known as non-cooperative countries or territories are put in the blacklist. Blacklist is also called high-risk jurisdiction subject to a call of action. So this is a list prepared by the FATF. So which countries are included in the blacklist? So which of these countries are included in the blacklist? Yes, very good, Neelam, Akash, and Dikshit. So this is a straightforward question. There are two countries that are mentioned in the blacklist, that is Iran and North Korea. So there are several other countries, I think some 15 countries or 18 countries are there in what is called the grey list. So India has been trying very hard to include Pakistan in the blacklist, but it still continues to be in the grey list. So this organization is often in the news. So study about the FATF, and there are two lists which are prepared by the FATF, blacklist and grey list. You must know FATF has two purposes. One is anti-money laundering and terror funding. So it deals with two crimes. One is money laundering and the other is terror funding. Okay. Let us move on to the next question. Question number 17. Consider the following statement. So I have given two statements of ozone, that is tropospheric ozone. Tropospheric or ground level ozone is not emitted directly into air, but is created by chemical reactions between oxides of nitrogen, volatile organic compounds. Ozone, that is tropospheric ozone, is most likely to reach unhealthy levels on hot sunny days in urban environments. So what is the answer here? So let us see how many of you answer this correctly. So yes, tropospheric ozone is not directly emitted into the air. So it is created by the chemical reaction that takes place between nitrogen oxides and volatile organic compounds. So this basically is mostly emitted from vehicles, vehicle or exhaust. Then it is very high during hot sunny days. So the levels of tropospheric ozone is very high in bright sunny days. So the answer is both A and B are correct. Okay, so very good. So let us move on to the next question. So the Drugs and Magic Remedies Objectionable Advertisements Act was enacted in the year. So the Drugs and Magic Remedies Objectionable Advertisements Act was enacted in the year. So this act was in the news because of an interesting incident. Patanjali Ayurved has released a kit called Coronil Kit to treat COVID-19. So this development has attracted a lot of criticism. And many people have objected to the release of the Coronil Kit on the ground that it violates a very important act of the parliament. So this is the Drugs and Magic Remedies Objectionable Advertisements Act. This act was enacted in the year 1954. Very good. So this is an act enacted in the year 1954. So if possible, study the features of this act. So this is an outdated act. Many people say that this is an outdated act, and there is a proposal to replace this act with a new act or amend this act. So as you can see here, this was enacted way back in 1954. So it is more than 60 years old. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. The best college of India according to the NIRF rankings. So NIRF, that is National Institutional Ranking Framework, the MHRD, that is Ministry of Human Resource Development, releases the rankings, NIRF rankings. So they are released in 9 categories, and you must know the institution which tops in each category. So the institution that tops in each category. So one of the categories is the best college of our country. So which is the best college of our country? So the best college of our country according to the Ministry of Human Resource Development is Miranda House. So Miranda House for the second consecutive year, I think, has been ranked as the best college of India. So a small factual topic, but very important for the exam. So let us see how many of you can answer the next question correctly. So India's unemployment rate fell marginally. So India's unemployment rate was in the news during the 2019 elections. So it was at an all-time high of 6.1%. That was 45 years. So it was the highest rate of unemployment registered in 45 years. So that was way back in 2017 and 18. But what does the latest numbers, so at least for 2018 and 19, say? What is the unemployment figure as far as 2018 and 19 are concerned? Here, if I have made a small mistake, I mean, you can make a guesswork also here. See, India's unemployment rate fell marginally. So I have already given an indication that it has fallen marginally in 2018-19 from 6.1%. So the answer must be less than 6.1. So in this case, there are only two options that are less than 6.1. So this is not correct and this is not correct. So you have to make a choice between these two options. So at times you can have such questions in the examination also. So the answer is 5.8%. So 5.8 is the percentage of unemployment rate in our country. Okay. So let us move on to the next question, 21. Most elections of the United Nations take place along regional lines. So the number of countries, so the number of regions into which the countries are divided. So the United Nations Security Council has 15 members, so 10 members are non-permanent and they are elected regionally. So the United Nations is divided into how many regions? The United Nations is divided into how many regions? Or the countries of the world are divided into how many regions? Okay, so this is a straightforward question. So this is easy. So five regions. So what are these regions? So Africa is one region. Asia Pacific is one region. Eastern Europe is one region. Western Europe and others is one region. And Latin America is one region. So the countries are divided into five groups and elections are usually held along regional lines. For example, the United Nations Security Council has 10 non-permanent members. So these are divided along regions. So all the 10 countries do not belong to a same region. Okay. Am I clear? So let us move on to the next question. The Commission on Agriculture Costs and Prices in the Ministry of Agriculture recommends MSP for how many products? So for how many products is the MSP announced? So this is actually confusing in nature. There are many versions of the MSP. I'm not sure about the answer for this question, but according to me, the number of products on which the MSP is announced is 22. Okay. So the CACP makes the recommendation. I mean, it is announced for 25 products, but CACP makes the recommendation for 22 products. Plus for sugarcane, we have FRP, it is not MSP. So this is something which you need to know. Plus there are two products whose MSP is derived from the MSP of other products. For example, there is this product called Toria and dehusked coconut. So their MSP is derived from the MSP of other products. So if you are asked this question on how many products or how many agricultural crops does the CACP make recommendations, so it is 22. So 22 is the answer, support, minimum support in one way or the other is extended by the government for 25 crops including the sugarcane. Okay, so very important. So please study about MSP, it is a commonly asked question in the examination. So let us move on to the next question. So consider the following factors: demand and supply, cost of production, price trends in the market, both domestic and international, intercrop price parity. So which of these factors are taken into consideration by CACP while determining the MSP? Okay, so the cost commission on agriculture costs and prices, CACP, makes recommendation on MSP based on 7 parameters or 7 factors. So these are 4 factors: demand and supply, cost of production, price trends in the international market, intercrop price parity, and there are 3 more factors. One is terms of trade between agriculture and non-agriculture, and a minimum of 50% as the margin on the cost of production, and the last factor is likely implication of MSP on consumers of that product. Okay, so there are 7 factors on the basis of which the MSP is recommended by CACP. So demand and supply, cost of production, price trends in the market, both domestic and international, intercrop price parity. Then the 5th factor is terms of trade between agriculture and non-agriculture. 6th factor, a minimum of 50% as the margin on the cost of production. And the 7th factor is likely implication of MSP on consumers of that particular product. So the answer is A. Neelam, is there any problem? Okay. So let us move on to the next question. Why is a plant called Prosperous juliflora often mentioned in the news? So this is a question which was taken from the 2018 examination. So this was asked, I think, in 2018 or 2017. So this was a previous question. So let us see how many of you can answer this. So if you have not completed your previous papers, that is civil services examination previous papers, please do them. Very, very important for the examination. Please finish the previous papers. Okay, so what is this plant Prosperous juliflora? Okay, very good. So it is an invasive species. So this is an example of an invasive species. An invasive species is a plant or an animal that is exotic in nature. So it is not native to a particular area. It has been introduced either deliberately or accidentally in a particular area. So something that is foreign to a particular area is invasive species, and it must cause or pose a threat. It must cause harm. It should spread rapidly and compete with the local species for limited resources. Over a period of time, the invasive species covers a large area and the local species are destroyed. So these invasive species pose a significant threat to biodiversity. So this is a major problem that is faced by our country in recent times. So we are seeing the spread of a number of invasive species. For example, Prosporus juliflora is an invasive species that is spreading rapidly in Gujarat. It is posing a significant threat to what is called bunny grasslands. So they are destroying what is called the bunny grasslands. Okay, so very, very important. Similarly, we have come across an invasive species called charu mussel, which is posing a significant threat to the fishermen of Kerala. So this is a mussel species which is native to Central America but is spreading rapidly in the backwaters of Kerala. So there has been a lot of discussion on the threat that is posed by charu mussel also. So if you have not read about this topic, invasive species, so please complete this topic. Very, very important for the examination. Okay, so let us see. There are a number of invasive species like Lanthana, Camara, Parthenium. We have several invasive species that are often heard in the news. Okay, let us see the next question. This is a straightforward, simple question. A commercial crew module program was launched by. Yes, Deekshit, you are correct. So there is a serious threat posed to the bunny grasslands by that plant, Prosporus juliflora. Many communities are also dependent on that. Okay, very good, Neelam. Yeah, what is the answer for this question? So this is the last question for today's exam. Commercial crew module program was launched by. So this is a very important question for this year's examination. The answer is SpaceX. So SpaceX became the first private company or a private space agency to launch a manned mission to space. So they have launched this mission called Commercial Crew Module Program, and this program has carried two astronauts to the International Space Station. So the International Space Station, which is located in the low Earth orbit, some 400 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. As of now, only the Russians are carrying astronauts to and from the International Space Station. They are carrying the astronauts using the Soyuz spacecraft. So all countries who want to send their astronauts to the International Space Station must use the services of the Soyuz spacecraft. So this is a very expensive spacecraft, and NASA has invited, the American government has invited private organizations to come up with ideas and develop vehicles which can take astronauts to the space. And SpaceX has come forward and they have developed this launch vehicle. So the launch vehicles that have been developed by SpaceX are called Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy. So you also please remember the names of the launch vehicles. So Commercial Crew Module Program, a major development in the field of space research is the Commercial Crew Module Program that has taken two astronauts to the International Space Station, and this has been carried out by SpaceX. So this is the exam for today. I hope you have liked the questions and understood the questions. So if you have any suggestions, so please give your suggestions. So I'll be looking at the chat box for a couple of minutes to see if there are any suggestions. So if you have any suggestions, Akash, Dikshit, Neelam, and others. So please give your suggestions so that I'll incorporate them in the next exam. So tomorrow, so I think you will receive an alert. So if you have subscribed to the Let's Crack UPSC CSE English channel, you will receive an alert. Tomorrow in the morning, we will have one class or exam. In the evening, we will have one class or exam. Okay, so any suggestions? Nothing. So I'll close the session in that place. So before closing the session, I would like to tell you, please use my code RRUPSC. So RRUPSC is my code. So please use this code when you subscribe to the Unacademy Plus platform. So thank you for listening and have a good day.